Okay. So faults in the power system. Generally, we have two types of the faults in the power system. And first one is open circuit faults. Open circuit faults. And the second one is short circuit faults. Short circuit faults. So generally, we have two types of the faults. Open circuit faults and short circuit faults. Open circuit faults are also called as series faults. Open circuit faults are also called as series faults. Short circuit faults are also called as shunt faults. Shunt faults. Okay. So what happened when open circuit faults taken place and short circuit fault taken place means, so when open circuit faults are taken place, then the terminal voltage of the system will be increased and the speed of the synchronous machine will be increased, frequency of the system will be increased, and the power factor of the system will also be increased. So these are the consequences happened whenever there exists an open circuit fault. The voltage of the particular system will be increased, speed of the synchronous machine will also be increased. As speed is increasing, frequency of the system will also be increased. And what happens when a short circuit fault is taken place means current flowing through the circuit will be increased in the power system. Current will be increased, the magnitude of the current is increased, and the speed is reduced. As speed is reduced, frequency definitely reduces because n is equal to 120 f by p. And most probably, like the power factor is going to be reduced. So this is the main important criteria in the short circuit faults. So comparatively, short circuit faults are more severe compared to open circuit faults. Okay, so open circuit faults, let us discuss first open circuit faults, then we'll go to short circuit faults. What happens when an open circuit fault taken place? Then actually, what do you mean by open circuit fault? Open circuit faults. Open circuit faults. We'll go slowly to the short circuit faults. Open circuit faults are in the form of melting of the fuse or separation of the circuit breaker contacts or snapping of the conductors in the overhead lines. So because of these three reasons, the open circuit faults will be taken place. So melting of the fuse means, so for example, this is a circuit diagram. Generally, we'll see in the labs. So DPST will be there like this here, right? So if I am taking a power system, so there will be a circuit diagram like this, single line circuit diagram. So this is a fuse. This is a fuse. If because of any reason, if the fuse is opened or melting of the fuse, if the fuse is melted, then there exists an open circuit here. Open circuit here. So this type of fault is called an open circuit fault. Open circuit fault. Melting of the fuse. First one is a melting of the fuse. And there are also some circuit breakers like this. Circuit breaker, function of the circuit breaker is to make the circuit and as well as break the circuit. Make the circuit and as well as break the circuit. So this is a open position, circuit breaker opened. So that means it is breaking the circuit. If you want to make the circuit, you have to close the circuit breaker contacts to these places, right? So whenever some kind of improper closing of circuit breaker, improper closing of the circuit breaker, which leads to open circuit of this entire network. So this is also leads to a open circuit fault. Fault means nothing but which is not a regular position. Okay, so that can be called as a fault, right? Melting of the fuse or improper closing of the circuit breaker. Improper closing of the circuit breaker leads to open circuit fault. And the third one is, snapping of the conductors in the overhead lines. So there is a overhead line like this in a tower, for a tower, particular tower, snapping means breaking of the circuit breaker, breaking of the transmission line. If any one of the transmission line got opened like this, like breaking of this particular line, then there exists again an open circuit fault, which you may not receive the terminal voltage as a desired voltage, a desirable voltage. Okay, so because of these reasons, you may experience open circuit faults. So what are the main reasons for having the open circuit faults? First one is melting of the fuse. Because of the melting of the fuse, you can get open circuit fault. Improper closing of the circuit breaker. And the third one is snapping of the conductors. Snapping of the transmission line or a conductors in the overhead lines. So because of these reasons, you may get open circuit faults. So here we have three phases. Right? So generally we will discuss with the three phases. First one is R phase, Y phase, and B phase. Okay. So because of any reason, one of the phase got opened, it may lead to open circuit fault. Or two phases got opened, this is also leads to a open circuit fault, right? So this R phase is opened here, and here R phase as well as Y phase both got opened here. So this is nothing but also open circuit fault. The transmission line is opened. In the third case, what are the chances to open? So I'm drawing different probable conditions for opening the transmission. So because as we have three transmission lines, which are operating in the power system. So here there are chances to have one of the transmission line got opened, two of the transmission line got opened, and three of the transmission line got opened. So these are the three probable conditions to open in a transmission line, right? So most probably we'll be facing this kind of open circuit faults. So reasons for opening these contacts means we are having three reasons: melting of the fuse, snapping of the conductors, and improper closing of the circuit breakers. Because of any reason, you may be experiencing these type of open circuit faults. But to be frank, you can say this as open circuit fault. This can also be called as open circuit fault, but this cannot be considered as an open circuit fault. This is very, very important. Why we are not considering this as a fault? Because as the three phases got opened, you may not consider this as a fault. You can consider this as a fault, but you cannot consider this as a fault, because this is nothing but the synchronous generator in the power system is working under no load condition. This is very important. This is working under no load condition, because as all the three phases got opened, load will be here, right? So load is disconnected here. That is the meaning of this thing. So in that case, it is not considered as a fault, because it is isolated. The load is isolated with respect to the generator. So this generator is now considered as it is working under no load condition. That's the reason why this is not considered as a fault. Whereas opening of any one of the phase, opening of any two phases, that can be treated as a fault condition. Okay. So in this no load condition, this voltage is a no load voltage only, or a rated voltage only. You may be having no load voltage. So this is regarding the open circuit fault. Conclusions are, open circuit faults may be because of melting of the fuse, improper closing of the circuit breaker, and snapping of the transmission line. And opening of any one of the transmission line can be considered as a fault. Opening of any two lines can be considered as a fault, but opening of all the three lines cannot be considered as a fault, because as it is similar to the synchronous generator working under no load condition. And coming to short circuit faults, these are the very important fault calculations in the power system. So short circuit faults. Now here, what are the reasons to have the short circuit faults? Short circuit faults. What are the reasons to have the short circuit faults? Yeah. Then short circuit faults. What are the chances to have the short circuit faults and how it can be happened? That means, generally, the current carrying elements, I mean to say the transmission lines, the current carrying elements will be employed with insulation on the surface of each conductor. Insulation will be provided on the conductor. Okay, in order to prevent the flow of current from one surface to another surface. I mean to say, in order to provide a short circuit path between two surfaces. If the insulation is failed, the current can flow from one surface to another surface, which is called as a short current or a shunt current. Okay. If any two phases are in touch with each other, then if insulation has been damaged, in that case, the current will be flowing through this shunt path. This is called shunt path. Current can be flowing through the shunt path. So this is called as a shunt faults. Shunt faults or a short circuit fault or a short circuit fault. Because of the insulation failure, you may be experiencing a short circuit fault. So that is the first conclusion. Because of insulation failure, you may be experiencing the short circuit fault. What are the another chances? So these are the transmission lines that may have. Okay. What are the another chances? You have to provide a shunt path. You have to provide a shunt path so that there exists a short circuit fault. So as and when there exists a shunt path, you may be experiencing a shunt fault or a short circuit fault. So these are the three lines that you have, and this is the ground. The chances to have the faults are any one of the line is falling on the ground, line to ground fault. Another case, two lines are falling on the ground, line to ground, or I mean to say like this line is falling on the ground, line to ground. So I'll explain here otherwise. So here I'm considering three lines. Line, RYB phases. So this is the ground. If any one of the line is falling on the ground, first case, line to ground fault. That is the first case. Second case, any two lines just falling on each other, not grounding, but each other in contact with one another. So any two lines are in contact with each other. Any two lines are in contact with each other. That can be called as line to line fault. Line to line fault. Okay, so this is the, otherwise I will explain each and everything with a simple diagram. So this is the first case, line to ground fault. Second case, these two lines are falling on each other. This is the second fault, line to ground, line to line fault. This is the line to ground fault. And in the third case, three lines are there. Two lines are falling on each other, and along with another line, it is falling on the ground. So that can be called as a line to ground fault. So another chance to have the short circuit fault is three lines are falling each other on each other. That can be considered as tribulel fault. And the last chance is three lines falling on each other and So the last chance is to have triple line falling on ground, triple LG fault. Triple lines falling on the ground, triple LG fault. So these are the probables for having the short circuit fault. First one is a line to ground fault. Second one is line to line fault. Third one is line to ground fault. Fourth one is triple L fault. And the fifth one is triple LG fault. Okay. So in this session, we are going to discuss regarding these faults. How can you categorize these faults? Means these are called triple line faults, and triple line to ground faults are called symmetrical faults. Symmetrical or balanced faults. Symmetrical or balanced faults. Regarding balanced faults, we have discussed in the previous session. So these are the symmetrical faults or balanced faults. And out of five, these are unsymmetrical faults. Unsymmetrical faults or unbalanced faults. Unsymmetrical faults or unbalanced faults. Right. So unsymmetrical faults are unbalanced faults, and whereas triple L and triple LG faults are symmetrical faults or balanced faults, or also you can call it as three phase faults, because three phases are affecting here. So that is the reason why you can call it as a three phase faults or symmetrical faults or balanced faults. Then out of these five, which one is most severe and which one is most frequently happening fault? So these are the very important questions asked in the competitive examinations. LG fault, double L fault, double LG fault, triple L fault, and the triple LG fault. Okay. So LG fault, the occurrence of LG fault is around 70%. 70% of the faults are LG faults only. 15% faults are double L faults, line to line faults, and line to ground fault is, chances of having these faults is around 10%, and the combination of these three phase faults is around 5% of chances. 5% of chances to have the three phase faults. Okay, so what is the answer for the question? Which is most frequently happening fault in the power system in a short circuit fault is LG fault. LG fault. So in the options, if LG fault is not mentioned and LL fault is given, double LG is given, triple L is given, triple LG is given, you have to go for the next fault. So this is the order of faults, frequently happening faults. So whichever it is there, that you have to act. So LG fault is there, then you have to put the answer as LG fault only. Okay. In case of severity, the order will be from bottom to top. Which is the most severe fault in the following faults means, this is the most severe fault, followed by triple L fault, after that double LG, double L fault, and LG fault. So most frequently happening fault, less severe fault. Less frequently happening fault, more severe fault. More severe fault. So in the previous session, we have discussed that positive sequence component, the significance of positive sequence component is to set the value of relays based on the fault calculations. I said in the topic, minimum value is set by LG fault, maximum fault is set by triple L fault or triple LG fault. This is for circuit breaker contact design. This is for relay setting, relay operating setting point. We have discussed these topics over there. So because minimum fault current or minimum less severe fault is LG fault, most severe fault is a three-phase fault. Okay. So these are the regarding faults happening in the short circuit calculation. Okay. You have to have a doubt here. What is the doubt means? Actually, you have to ask me the doubts. But anyway, in future, if you are referring to any material, you may be facing the doubt. So at that time, you are unable to contact. So that is the reason why I'm explaining here only. So if you consider short circuit fault and open circuit faults. So this is the three phases. Okay, so these are the three phases synchronous machine. What is this one? This figure is indicating that three phases got opened, and here I am taking it as three phases got shorted. What is this type of fault? Tribulel fault, which is there in our types of faults, short circuit faults. Sir, when you are saying that when all the phases got opened, you are not treating it as a fault. Whereas when all the phases are got shorted, you are treating it as a fault, and you are calling it as most severe fault. What is the reason why we have to consider this as a fault, especially most severe fault, and why we are not considering this as a fault at least? Okay, so that doubt is a valid doubt and very important doubt also for an electrical engineer, because I said this is nothing but is very much similar to a open circuit working under no load condition. That means it is operating at a rated condition. Output voltage across these terminals is a rated voltage only. Whereas if you coming to this short circuit current, when all the phases are shorted, this is very much more than the rated value, very much higher than the rated value. Because all the phases are got shorted, the short circuit current which is flowing through these phases will be more than the rated values, That is the reason why you are considering this as a fault. You are not considering this as a fault. Simply, what do you mean by a fault? When you can call it as a fault? When somebody is asking like, what do you mean by fault? You need not to refer any textbooks or any materials related to this. Simply you call whenever these parameters, voltage and current parameters, are violating its rated values, then that can be called as a fault. If V rated is more than, if the voltage is more than the rated value, what is the, if the voltage is more than the rated value, then that can be called as a fault. If current is rated more than the rated value, that can be called as a fault. Okay, so here in this case, voltage is not violated its value, rated value, but here in this case, it has been violated its value. Therefore, this is called as a fault. Generally, for a human being also, when the body temperature is under the rated value, then you are in a good condition. If the body temperature is more than the rated value, then you may be calling it as a, you got sick. Similarly, you should not have the violated values of its parameters, then that can be called as a fault, right? Next. So where the faults will be happening? Most of the electrical faults in a power system is unbalanced faults only. Okay, so this is the power system. Simple circuit diagram I'm explaining here. Generally, you may be having a generator, for a transformer, step up transformer and a step down transformer, and a load. So this is a load, right? So generator is most protected equipment in the power system, and the transformer is having its own protection. And our short circuit faults will be generally happened in this area, transmission line, because all the lines are, we are talking regarding line to ground, line to line, line to line to line, like that. So the most concentrated area in the power system is transmission lines. So you have to take more care on this transmission line for a fault calculation. So if you want to calculate, the fault analysis for a transmission line, transmission line is nothing but having resistance, inductance, and capacitance. Is it correct? The transmission line is represented with a resistance, inductance and capacitance with respect to ground. Okay, so what are these elements actually? These are distributed elements. So in the network theorem you will be studying like distributed elements. Physically it will not be appeared, but the effect will be existing here. Lumped elements and distributed elements, right? So each transmission line is having a resistor, inductor, as well as a capacitor. Resistor, inductor, and as well as a capacitor. These values are distributed values, not lumped values. Physically, you cannot find these parameters, but the effect of these parameters will be always existing in the field. So you have to have these parameter analyzation. When you analyze these parameters, then you may be having the analysis of this fault current. But this transmission line is a passive element. Passive element, that means there is no energy source for the transmission line. You cannot analyze the transmission lines, because if you want to analyze the current or voltage parameters, you must have a power flow or a current flow through the transmission line. Whereas it is a passive element, how can you analyze this? You cannot analyze the transmission line. So for that analysis purpose, I am considering a synchronous generator which is connected to the transmission line under the assumption of the synchronous machine and the network is in steady state condition. And the network is under steady state condition. Okay, now I am analyzing when a fault is happened to the transmission line, what will be happening to the transmission line whenever there is a fault. Which type of fault I am discussing here? It is a short circuit fault. So I am just taking most severe fault as a three-phase fault. So this is a fault happened on the transmission line. As and when the transmission line is experiencing a short circuit fault, the effect of these capacitances will be ignored, because the effect of capacitance with respect to ground will be ignored, because there is a short circuit path. That is the reason why the capacitance can be ignored. So what are the elements which is presenting in the transmission line whenever there exists a short circuit fault? So I am converting this into the network. So I am considering this as a voltage source, synchronous machine, and you may be having the resistance value and as well as the inductance value. And there exists a short circuit fault. So this is the neutral, this is a phase R L, and this is a V, which is equal to Vm sine omega t AC. Sine omega t plus alpha. I will explain what is alpha. Okay, so whenever there exists a short circuit path, then this is called a fault current. I fault current. Fault current will be flowing in this direction. Fault current will be flowing in this direction. Okay. Right. So at t is equal to zero, there is a short circuit in the overhead transmission line. Because of that short circuit path, the effect of capacitances have been ignored here, and it can be represented with a circuit here. And here the value of voltage source V is equal to Vm sine omega t plus alpha. This alpha is the time where the fault is taken place. I will explain through the graph. Okay, this is a voltage waveform. V is equal to Vm sine omega t. And alpha is nothing but where the exact location of the fault which is existing in the voltage waveform, right? So this is a maximum value. Then RMS value will be Vm is equal to, V is equal to Vm by root 2. So therefore, I can write instead of Vm, I can write root 2 V sine omega t plus alpha. This is the value of this voltage source I'm just taking. Okay, so the angle of the alpha which is representing is here is the exact location of the fault. Actually, this is a voltage waveform. Generally, we have a sinusoidal voltage waveform, right? So if fault is happening here, these are called zero crossing points. These are called zero crossing points. Zero crossing points. zero crossing points. So we don't know where the fault is happening. If, for example, fault is happened here, then with respect to time, this is alpha. This is alpha. Alpha with respect to zero crossing points. So the fault location with respect to zero crossing points is called alpha. So based on this, we are having the analysis. So I am drawing the waveforms for the fault analysis. Otherwise, we'll go first the network equation. Apply KVL in this equation. What you'll be having here? We are having resistance R into I plus L into di by dt, which is equal to root 2 V into sine omega t plus alpha. So this is a first order linear differential equation. First order linear differential equation. Now, by solving this one, you will be having the value of this current. You'll be having the value of this current as Im sine omega t plus alpha minus pi. This is a phase difference between voltage and current, because this is due to inductive in nature. The load is inductive in nature. K into e power of minus t by tau. This tau is the time constant of the transmission line, where it can be calculated as L by R. Okay. So here Im can also be written as root 2 V by R or Z. You can take it as Z, sine omega t plus alpha minus pi plus k into e power of minus t by tau. So this is the current equation. So this entire short circuit current, this is what here, short circuit current, which is having the components of a steady state sinusoidal waveform, plus an exponential decaying transient waveform. This is exponential decaying transient waveform and a steady state waveform. The combination of these two is the fault current. So whenever there exists a fault, so you know very well regarding the transients, when switch is closed or switch is opened, suddenly at a t is equal to 0 switch is opened, that means there is exist a fault. Or at t is equal to 0 the switch is closed here, because it is a short circuit fault. Inductor doesn't allow the sudden changes in the current. It takes some transient current, transient duration. After that, it reaches to steady state condition. So there is also, because of the fault, you may be experiencing the transient current, and after that there exists a steady state sinusoidal current. So the combination of these two is the fault current. Okay. So how can you calculate this magnitude of this transient effect? That means by using initial conditions. At t is equal to 0, fault is happened. Therefore, at 0, the current will be 0. At I of 0, the current will be 0. So if you replace with respect to 0 with the above equation, root 2 V by Z sine omega t plus alpha minus pi plus k into e power of minus t by tau, then this one becoming 0, right? E power of 0 is equal to 1. Now this will become like k is equal to minus root 2 V by Z sine. Here also you can put 0, because I have 0. T, I of t will be 0, therefore it will be 0 sine alpha minus pi. So this is the value of k. Why this minus? Minus is decaying negative DC effect. I will explain through the graph. Now the equation of the fault current will become now root 2 V by Z sine omega t plus alpha minus pi minus root 2 V by Z sine alpha minus pi. So this is your fault current in a short circuit fault, which is having a sinusoidal steady state current along with a negative DC component or a transient component or a heat effect. Where is the heat effect having maximum value means this is a DC effect or heat effect or a transient effect. This is root 2 V by Z sine alpha minus pi. What, where is the maximum value here means when sine 0 is equal to 0 and sine 90 is equal to 1. So there are two cases, minimum and maximum condition. If alpha is equal to pi, if alpha is equal to pi, then you may be having minimum condition. Then it will be sine 0, alpha minus alpha, or pi minus pi is equal to 0. Sine 0 is equal to 0. Therefore, there is no DC effect. There is no transient effect or a DC effect. Second condition, if alpha minus pi is equal to 90 degrees, alpha minus pi is equal to 90 degrees. Therefore, the maximum value of DC current is root 2 V by Z. So this is asked in the gate examination once. What is the maximum? What is the maximum value of DC effect? Is root 2 V by Z. Root 2 V by Z. That means the value of alpha minus pi should be equal to pi by 2. So whenever alpha is equal to pi, there is no DC effect. What is this alpha is equal to pi? I have explained here the location of the fault. The location of the fault. When alpha is equal to pi or at a zero crossing point, there is no DC effect or there is no transient effect. So we should think that the fault is happening at a zero crossing point. Therefore, the fault effect is zero. When alpha minus pi is equal to 90 degrees, this is a 90 degrees, then the value of transient effect is high. The value of transient effect is high. So this is asked in the gate examination once. The maximum value of transient effect or a fault current will be existing at alpha minus pi is equal to 90 degrees, and the magnitude is given as minus root 2 V by Z. Okay. So what are the conclusions of this entire derivation is the instantaneous current of the fault is having a subtransient period or a transient period with variable current with respect to time. It is measured in RMS value. Okay. So I will explain in a graph. So this is a voltage waveform V, let us take. And this is a current waveform which is having a phase displacement of 5. Am I correct? So this is a phase displacement of 5. This is V, this is I. And fault is taking place at alpha. This is alpha position. Then it is having a DC effect, transient DC effect. The combination of the fault current is, this is transient, and here a steady state sinusoidal current, and the total current, this is somewhat curve, so consider it as a straight line. Now I am drawing the final waveform of the fault current, which is having a sinusoidal along with the DC component. So this is a negative DC component which is exponentially decaying. So this is measured in RMS value. The fault current is measured in RMS value only. Okay. So this is the effect of fault current in the transmission line. And it is also similar in case of generator also. Both the cases will be having the same effect only. Right. So this is regarding the introduction of faults. Now we'll go to the fault calculations. So what are the faults we have? LG fault, LL fault, double LG fault, triple L fault, as well as triple LG fault. So before going to the fault calculation, so be careful here. Fault calculations. So generally, the power system, this is a voltage which is generated at generator, and this is a bus bar voltage array, terminal voltage. Let us take it as a unit. So V per unit is equal to actual value by base value. So it is taken as 1 per unit. For simplicity or for ease of calculations, always we will take the bus bar voltage as a 1 per unit only. 1 per unit only. If there is a change in the voltage, there is a change in the voltage, then the per unit value is going to be reduced. Okay. So generally we will take a V as a per unit only. Bus bar voltage and as well as the generated voltage will consider as the same for ease of calculations. Okay, which is called as a pre-fault voltage, or we can call it as a pre-fault voltage. Pre-fault voltage. Before fault, it is nothing but pre-fault voltage. Now, first case, consider the line to ground fault. Line to ground fault. Line to ground fault. So I am considering three lines here. This diagram we have discussed in the previous session. Synchronous machine having individual phases, R phase, Y phase, B phase. So every time I am going to take this diagram for all the faults, so I would like to take this picture. Okay. Here the first fault is line to ground fault, right? So I am just any one of the phase you can take. I'm just taking only R phase as the reference for all the faults. So this fault became grounded. It's very clear. So listen carefully. Don't deviate. If you deviate, means the entire things will gone. What I have to say, this one, it has a fault current, IF. Fault current, because R phase became faulted. Fault current. Now this is called IR, R phase current. This is Y phase current. This is B phase current. As and when the fault is taken place, entire current will flow through this. Entire current will flow through this faulted section only, because there exists a short path. There exists a short circuit path. That is, this current is always trying to flow through a less resistive path. I mean to say, like a short circuit path. So ultimately, the values of these phases will become zero. These phases becomes zero. And another one, voltage with respect to this R phase will also become zero, because there exists a short circuit. Every time, whenever there exists a short circuit, the voltage across the short circuit is always zero. Is always zero. Okay. So these are the main conclusions for analyzing a LG fault. Okay, I repeat here, when if R phase is falling on the ground, called a line to ground, R phase or any one of the phase out of R by B, I'm just taking R as a reference, then R phase is falling on the ground, then I am calling it as a line to ground fault. Whenever it is falling on the ground, the value of this fault current is nothing but the R phase current, and the remaining two phases will have zero currents, and the voltage of particular phase will also becomes zero. Okay, so these conclusions I'm writing here for LG fault. First one is the fault current, which is nothing but the any phase which is falling on the ground. I have taken R phase, so it is IF is equal to IR. And Y phase is becoming zero value, and the current flowing through the B phase is also zero, and the voltage at R phase is also become zero. Okay, so these are the parameters which are unbalanced. Because of the fault, these become unbalanced. And from the previous session, I have given a matrix to calculate zero sequence components, positive sequence components, and negative sequence components from an unbalanced conditions is 1/3 R phase, Y phase, and B phase. Am I correct? From the matrix I have explained in the previous session, IR0, IR1, IR2. Otherwise, you just go through after the session. Meanwhile, you take the formula. Same formula for all the sequences, like IY can be written as K into IY for positive sequence. And this is for negative sequence, K square into IB. IR2 can be taken as 1/3 IR plus K square into IY plus K into IB. Okay, man. So these are the formulas which we have discussed in the previous session. Okay, for calculation of zero sequence, positive sequence, and negative sequence from the unbalanced parameters. Substitute these conclusions here. IY is zero here. IY is zero. IY is zero. IB is also zero. So similarly, here also it is zero. This one also zero. This one also zero. From these conclusions, right? So what is the resultant here? IR by 3. What is the resultant here? IR by 3. This one, IR by 3. So you got another conclusion here. IR naught is equal to IR1 is equal to IR2 is equal to the same value IR by 3. Okay, but here, what is this IR? Fault current. So I can write fault current is equal to IR, which is equal to this 3 will be multiplied with all these things. 3IR0, which is equal to 3IR1, which is equal to 3IR2. This is your short circuit fault current for a LG fault. Very, very important formula. Fault current IF is equal to any one of the phase which is affecting, that means R phase IR, which is equal to 3 times of zero sequence component current, or which is equal to 3 times of positive sequence component, or which is equal to 3 times of negative sequence component IR2. Now, if you are able to calculate these sequence component currents, then your fault current calculation is done. Okay. And you have to remember one point. You are having 3 sequences. This is very, very valid point. You are having 3 sequences, positive sequence, negative sequence, zero sequence components. Yesterday we have, in the previous class, we have discussed with that positive sequence and negative sequence are with respect to neutral, and zero sequence component is with respect to ground. This one we have explained in the previous session. And also you have the faults, LG fault, LL fault, LLG fault, LLL fault, triple LG faults. Okay. In every case, in a power system, definitely there exists a positive sequence component. These are the system sequence components, or generated sequence components, or original sequence components. So in each and every condition, that means before fault and as well as after faults, every time positive sequence components will be present. Whenever the system becomes unbalanced, along with the positive sequence component, a negative sequence component and as well as zero sequence component will be existing. This is in case of fault condition. So this is, I'm calling it as a pre-fault case. and this is a fault during fault case. During fault case. Okay. Now, whenever these faults are associated with respect to ground, these faults are associated with respect to ground, then in that case, along with the positive sequence component, zero sequence component will be definitely existing. And what about this negative sequence component means? Whenever there is an unbalanced fault, in that case, negative sequence component will be existing. Whenever there is a balanced case, in that case, zero sequence component will never exist. So a lot of confusion will be there, but I am making it very simple for you. Okay. I'll write here again. So three conclusions are here. Pre-fault case or any case, every time what is the component which is present? This is a positive sequence component. During fault or after fault or before fault. If there is an unbalanced fault, at that time negative sequence component exists. If there is a fault associated with ground, at that case, zero sequence component exists. We know that out of five faults I have given in the starting that yes, here these three faults are unbalanced faults and these two faults are balanced faults. These three faults are unbalanced and these two faults are balanced faults. What is that meaning here? Out of five faults, in these three faults there exists a negative sequence component. Here there is no negative sequence component. So that's what the meaning here. Okay. Right. Now you are having a conclusion here. First one. LG fault, which is an unbalanced fault and a ground fault. So what are the sequence present here? Definitely positive sequence present. Negative sequence is also present because it is an unbalanced fault associated with the ground. Then zero sequence component is also exist. Line two fault. Definitely positive sequence. After that, an unbalanced fault, negative sequence. And there is no ground, therefore zero sequence component will not exist. Line to ground fault. Positive sequence, unbalanced, so negative sequence, ground, zero sequence component. Triple L fault. Positive sequence component. It is a balanced component, no negative sequence. It is not associated with the ground, no zero sequence component. Triple LG fault. Positive sequence component, which is a balanced component, no negative sequence, and associated with the ground, hence it is having zero sequence component. So this is the main important sequence that you have to calculate and you have to remember for the fault analysis. Very, very important. So first of all, I'm calculating for LG fault so that I may be calculating these three sequence components. Okay. Therefore, I am replacing with the LG fault. I'm replacing with the diagram here. It is having positive sequence component represented with the symmetrical component network we have discussed in the previous session. This is IR1 with respect to phase and a neutral. In the previous session, we have discussed this one. This is the ER1 positive sequence component. This is X1 equivalent positive sequence equivalent value. And second one, negative sequence component. We do not have the ER2 because when the fault is happened, then that case only positive sequence only exist, there is no negative sequence component. So this is also with respect to neutral x2 equivalent, right? After that, zero sequence component, this is phase versus neutral, sorry, versus ground. This is x not equivalent. This is with respect to ground. Now, whenever a line to ground fault is taken place, the fault current is equal to the phase current IR, and which is equal to zero sequence component and positive sequence component and negative sequence component. All the sequence component currents are same. This condition will be holds good as and when these three sequence components are in series connection. Then only the current flowing through all the components will be equal in magnitude. So I could write here, these three sequence components, I can connect them in a series manner. Therefore, the sequence component current will be same. So this I am connecting in series. So this is the fault current, line to ground fault current, line to ground fault current, and all these fault currents are in series. So this is IR naught, this is IR2, this is IR1, all are same, which is equal to fault current. So this is my diagram for a line to ground fault. So this is asked in an examination that all the three sequence components are connected in series, then the type of the fault is dash. All the network sequence components are connected in series, then the type of the fault is line to ground fault. Line to ground fault. I want to calculate the value of the fault current by using this equation. We know that R phase, when it is falling on the ground, the voltage at R phase is equal to zero, VR is equal to zero. So whenever this is unbalanced, then I am representing with respect to all unbalanced parameters by using sequence components, which is equal to zero. Am I correct? An unbalanced parameter is represented with respect to three balanced parameters. And I know the values of VR1 from the network symmetrical networks. I have also given a matrix for this in the previous session. X1 equivalent minus IR2 X2 equivalent minus IR0 X0 equivalent, which is equal to zero. So from here, I can write ER1 is equal to, I am replacing IR1, IR2 with respect to IR1 only, because all are in series connection. Just now we have seen all the values are also same. All the values are also same. So all are in same. So I am representing with the IR1. So I am replacing with the IR1 X1 minus IR1 X2 equivalent to minus IR1 X0 equivalent. I can take IR1 as common. Taking it IR1 as common, X1 plus X2 plus X0. So IR1 can be written as ER1 by X1 plus X2 plus X0. X1 plus X2 plus X0. So this is my IR1. Or what is my fault current? IF is equal to 3 times of IR1 or 3 times of IR0 or IR2. 3 times of IR0. So I wanted to calculate the fault current for an LG fault 3 times of IR1 is equal to ER1 by X1 plus X2 plus X0. So this is your final fault current calculation for an LG fault. For an LG fault. So this is a way to calculate LG fault for a fault condition. Okay. After that, second fault is line to line fault. Line to line fault. So I'm just taking here again the same diagram. So this is R face, Y face, and B face. Okay. Now, line to line fault. So I'm just taking here these two lines shorted. These two lines shorted. So this is my fault current. This is my fault current. Fault current will be flowing like this. Okay. Actually, this is IR. This is IY. This is IB. Now, what are the conclusions of this diagram? So, this is the line to line fault current. Okay. Now, this IR will become zero because there exists a short circuit path here. First conclusion is IR is becoming zero. IF fault current is equal to IY. This is fault current only IY, which is equal to minus of IB in the negative direction. Minus of IB. Minus of IB. And what is the third conclusion? The potential at VY is same as the potential at VB, B phase. The potential at Y phase and potential at B phase both are at same position only, and these are unbalanced manner. Unbalanced. Okay. And we know that line to line fault is a unsymmetrical fault and not associated with the ground. Therefore, what are the sequences present? Positive sequence along with the negative sequence. But there is no zero sequence component because it is not associated with the ground. So I can calculate IR1 as well as IR2, and IR0 will become anyway zero because there is no negative sequence component, sorry, zero sequence component. Right? Let us see whether it is correct or not. What is the formula for IR0? 1/3 IR1 plus IR2 plus IR0. Right? IR1 is 0. IR1 is 0. IY is equal to minus IB. So this is IR plus IY plus IB. IR0 is equal to IR plus IY plus IB, right? So IR is anyway 0. IY is equal to minus IB, or IB is equal to minus IY. From this, IY is equal to minus IB, or you can take any one of these, then this will become, this entire combination will become 0. So it is also proved because it is not a ground fault. Therefore, it is becoming zero. Now it is, IR1 can be written as IR plus K into IY plus K square into IB. We know that IR is zero, and K into IY, I can write K into IY only, plus IB I'm writing as minus of IY. So therefore, minus K square into IY, because IB is equal to minus of IY. Okay. here it is 1 by 3. Take I y as common. If you take it as common, it will be k minus k square. For IR 2, 1 by 3, IR plus k square into IY plus k into IB. So this will also become 0 plus k square IY. Again, I'm writing IB with respect to IY only. I'm replacing with IY. Again, it is take IY as common. This will be k square minus k, which is equal to minus of IR1. Am I correct? So same only, but the sign is different. K square minus k here, and it is k minus k square, which is equal to minus IR. So the conclusion is here. IR1 is equal to IY by 3 k minus k square, and IR2 is equal to minus of IY by 3 k minus k square, which is equal to minus of IR1. And the third one is the sequence component 0 sequence is 0. So IR1 and IR2 both are in opposite direction, anti-parallel connection. That is the reason why the minus sign is indicating here. Anti-parallel condition means, so this is, let us take a positive sequence component, then the negative sequence component will be like this. These are connected in anti-parallel condition. IR1 is flowing in this direction, IR2 is flowing in this direction, then the direction of these currents will be in reverse. IR1 in this direction, IR2 is in this direction. So the direction of these currents are in reverse. So this type of connection is called anti-parallel connection, once asked in the public sector examination. So as like in the previous case, when the net sequence components are connected in series, the type of the fault is line to ground fault. When the sequence components are connected in anti-parallel connection, the type of the fault is line to line fault or anti-parallel connection. And here VY is equal to VB. VY is equal to VB from the fault. So I can write like VY1 plus VY2 plus VY0 and VB1 plus VB2, you can write capital, plus VB0. Unbalanced parameters are replacing with a set of balanced parameters, and as it is a line to line fault, there is no zero sequence component, and IY1 can be replaced with K square into VR1 and K times of VR2 is equal to K into VR1 plus K square into VR2. You take VR1 together and take it common, then this will become K square minus K, and VR2 here, this will become K square minus K, which will be cancelled out each other, and you will be left with VR1 is equal to VR2. The sequence components of the two phases will be same. So how can you calculate VR1 by using network symmetrical components? IR1 is equal, VR1 is equal to ER1 minus IR1 into X1 equivalent is equal to minus of IR2 into X2 equivalent. These are, I have taken from the symmetrical networks, which we have discussed in the previous session. Therefore, ER1 can be written as IR1 X1 equivalent minus IR2 X2 equivalent. We know that IR1 and IR2 are in anti-parallel connection. So therefore, instead of minus IR2, I can take plus IR1. So that the equation will become now plus IR1 X2 equivalent. If you take ER1 as common, this will become now X1 equivalent plus X2 equivalent. So this is your ER1. I'm writing in terms of IR1, which is equal to ER1 by, simply I'm writing X1 plus X2. X1 plus X2. Okay. What is the fault current? My fault current IF is equal to IY. Am I correct? Because it is a line to line fault, I can take like this, right? So my fault current is IF is equal to IYR minus of IB. So I am taking this condition, IF is equal to my IF, IY is I fault current is equal to IY. So this one, the value of IY is equal to what here? 3 into IR1 divided by K minus K square. This one we have just now we have written. So 3 into IR1 divided by what is the K? In the previous class it is minus 0.5 plus J 0.8667 minus K square minus 0.5 minus J 0.8667, the value of K square. So if you compute this one, this fault current is equal to IY, which is equal to root 3 times of IR1. Okay, now so this will become root 3 and the entire thing will become now root 3 times of IR1. So what is IR1 here? This is a value. So therefore, the fault current is equal to root 3 times of ER1 divided by X1 plus X2. So this is your fault current for line to line fault. Fault current for line to ground fault is IF is equal to ER1 by X1 plus X2 plus X0. Whereas the fault current for line to line fault is root 3 times of ER1 divided by X1 plus X2. X1 plus X2. So this is the case for line to line fault. Line to line fault. So we are having remaining two faults. The third fault is very much important and somewhat difficult to understand at the time of sequence networks. So careful regarding this one. If you completed this one, then almost all the faults have been completed. Line to line and ground fault, double LG fault. Okay, so same diagram I'm taking here again. Line to line ground fault, line to line as well as ground fault. So this is R phase, Y phase, B phase, and this is my fault current. Very simple. As it is a short circuit fault, then the value of IR is becoming zero here. What are the conclusions? First conclusion is IR is becoming zero and fault current is equal to IY plus IB. If you apply KCL here, the fault current is IY plus IB. The combination of these IY current as well as IB current is the fault current. Here it is. So earlier it is IY is equal to minus of IB. Earlier it is a line to line fault. So therefore fault current has been circulated between these two phases, but now it is becoming grounded. Therefore the fault current is the combination of these two phases, IY plus IB. As IR is equal to zero and here these two are shorted. Therefore VY is equal to VB is equal to zero. In the earlier case, very careful, in the earlier case line to line fault, these two voltages are at same potential but not equal to zero, but here it is a short circuited to the ground, therefore it becomes zero. Okay, And another conclusion is here, it is asymmetrical fault, double LG. So there exists a positive sequence, a negative sequence, as well as a zero sequence components. So we have to calculate these three sequence components. Let us calculate. What is VR naught, which is equal to 1 by 3 VR plus VY plus VB, which is equal to VY and VB becomes 0, na? Here. VY and VB becomes 0. So therefore, this will be now VR by 3. VR1 is equal to 1 by 3 times of VR plus K times of VY plus K square times of VB. Anyway, these two are 0. So again, it is VR by 3. VR2 is equal to 1 by 3 times of VR plus K square VY plus KVB. So this will become again 0. So again, this will be VR by 3. The conclusion is here, VR0 is equal to VR1 is equal to VR2 is equal to VR by 3. So this is the conclusion from this line to ground fault from the basic things. So in GenCo 2012, a question has been asked from this. In case of line to ground fault, the network terminal voltages are equal. The network terminal voltages are equal and equal to VR by 3. VR by 3. Okay. Here comes the calculation part. Concentrate more on this part. So here we know the value of IR, which is equal to 0. Right, from the fault condition. So therefore, IR1 plus IR2 plus IR0 is equal to 0. Here, we know that VR1 is equal to VR2. VR1 is equal to VR2. So therefore, ER1, this is I have taken from the above condition here. VR1 is taken from this case. First I have equated these two cases. Later I will equate these two cases and I will substitute in the above equation. So first of all, I have taken from VR1 is equal to VR2 case. From this I am writing VR1 is equal to IR1 X1 is equal to minus of IR2 X2, right? So here, minus of IR2 is equal to ER1 minus IR1 into X1 divided by X2. So I am removing this negative sign. ER1 IR1 into X1 divided by X2. So this minus one, minus sign becomes plus. So I'm just keeping in the bracket so that it will become now. So IR2 value is this one. Similarly, if you take VR1 is equal to VR0, again, the same principle, ER1 minus IR1 into X1 is equal to minus IR0 into X0. And from here, I am directly writing IR0 is equal to minus of ER1 minus IR1 X1 divided by writing the others. X naught. So you substitute in the these two values, you substitute IR2 values and IR0 value, you substitute in this equation. So you'll get the final equation like IR1 minus IR1 minus IR1 into X1 divided by X2 minus IR1 minus X1 R1 IR1 divided by IR1 X1 divided by X0 is equal to 0. From all these things, I wanted to calculate, I'm interested to calculate only IR1. So this one, I will get IR1 divided by X1 plus X2 into X0. So I'm writing the conclusion part here, X2 plus X0. So this is the value of IR1. IR1. So what is this meaning here? How these sequence components are connected from this equation? Zero sequence component, negative sequence component are connected in parallel. This is a parallel circuit formula. And this combination is connected in series with the positive sequence component. Series with the positive sequence component. So how can you draw this means? Let us take this is a positive sequence component, negative sequence component, zero sequence component. Okay, so positive sequence, negative sequence, this is positive and this is zero sequence component. Negative sequence component, zero sequence components are connected in parallel. So that means this one connected together. Okay, and negative terminals connected together. This is the meaning of this thing. This is a negative sequence component, this is zero sequence component connected in parallel. This is a parallel connection, and the combination of these is connected in series with the positive sequence component. So this is IR1, this is IR0, this is IR2, this is IR2. So this IR1 is now dividing into two, IR2 and IR0, dividing into two currents, IR2 and IR0. So this is the meaning of this thing. Okay, so from this current division rule, from this current division rule, how can you calculate IR2? This is the main current coming towards the node, and IR2 can be calculated as IR1 into zero sequence component reactants X0 divided by negative sequence component reactants as well as zero sequence component from the current division rule principle. This one we know very well. IR2 is nothing but IR1 into X0 divided by X0 plus X2. Similarly, IR0 can be calculated as IR1 into negative sequence component divided by negative sequence component and as well as zero sequence component currents. Okay, this is a main problem to confuse here. I will conclude once again from this starting of this fault. So this is a line to ground fault. So most important fault in the examination purpose also. So line to line and ground fault. So IR will be zero and IY plus IB is the combination of the fault current. VY is equal to VB, which is equal to zero. And from this conclusions, I have taken VR0 is equal to 1 by 3 into VR plus VY plus VY. And VR1 is equal to 1 by 3 times of this one. These will become zero anyway. So the conclusion is from here, VR0 is equal to VR1 is equal to VR2 is equal to VR by 3. I'm taking two conditions at a time for writing IR2 and IR0, and I'm substituting in the unbalanced equation this case. So by taking this condition, I got IR2 to substitute here, and IR0 can be obtained by taking this condition, and I got this value substituted here, calculated for IR1, I got this one. From this equation, it is very clear that negative sequence component and zero sequence components are connected in parallel, and the combination is in series with the positive sequence component. That means IR1 is dividing into IR2 and IR0. To calculate IR2, this is the main amount of current by using current division rule principle. IR1 into zero sequence component reactants divided by the total sum of negative and zero sequence components. Similarly, IR0 also. So that I have written the equations of these. Now, I am calculating the fault current. What is my fault current? IF is equal to IY plus IB. That is from the diagram. This can be written as IY0 plus IY1 plus IY2 plus IB0 plus IB1 plus IB2. I am replacing with all these parameters with R0, R phase, K square into IR1 plus K into IR2, IR0, K into IR1 plus K square into IR2. This is 2 into IR0 plus, take IR1 as common, K plus K square, take IR2 as common, K square plus K. We know that 1 plus K square is equal to 0. Then K plus K square is equal to minus 1. Okay, it is minus 1. What happened here now? Instead of K plus K square, you substitute minus 1. You substitute minus 1. Therefore, the fault current IF is equal to 2 into IR0 minus of IR1 and minus of IR2. And you know this equation. This one. IR0 can be written as minus of IR1 minus of IR2 from this equation. So I am writing, instead of minus of IR1 minus of IR2, I am writing IR0. So the fault current is now becoming 3 IR0. The fault current is becoming 3 IR0. What is IR0? We have calculated here. This is IR0. What is IR1? We have calculated here. This is IR1. So I am writing at a point concluded. Fault current calculation IF is equal to 3 IR0, which is equal to 3 into IR1 into X2 equivalent divided by X2 plus X0, where IR1 is equal to, IR1 is equal to, what is the value of IR1 here? ER1 divided by X1 plus X2 into X0 divided by X2 plus X0. So this is a final value. So actual, what is your fault current here? This is the main complete formula for calculating the fault current. So to calculate IF, you must calculate 3 IR0. To calculate IR0, you have to calculate IR1. So this is the equation for calculating the fault current. Equation for calculating the fault current. Okay, in case of double LG fault, the last fault is triple L fault. So the last fault is trivial fault. This is a symmetrical fault. Triple L fault or symmetrical fault. What are the sequences present here? Positive sequence and negative, sorry, no negative sequence, because it is a symmetrical fault. And as it is a not associated with the ground, hence it is a no zero sequence component. So only positive sequence component will be existed, right? So the diagram for this one, the circuit diagram for this one is, R phase, Y phase, B phase, triple L fault. Line to ground fault. Line to line fault. This is R phase, Y phase current, and B phase current. Right? So here, fault current IF is equal to IR, which is equal to IY, which is equal to IB. So because it is a balanced current, Okay. So because of that, the fault current is same because of the balanced current. So IR plus IY plus combination of these, IR plus IY plus IB is equal to zero because of the balanced condition. So therefore, VR is equal to VY is equal to VB. So because this is a balanced condition, right? So we can calculate IR naught here. What is the formula? 1 by 3 of IR plus IY plus IB. So blindly we can say that this is zero because there is no zero sequence component existing in the triple L fault. It's a balanced fault. And as well as the combination of these three will become here zero because of the balanced condition. And IR1 is equal to 1 by 3 times of IR plus K into IY plus K square into IB, right? So this one I can write somewhat important point here. So IR, I can write K into IY. IY can be written as what here in terms of IR1? K square times of IR1. So this is very, very important. And again, K square into IB can be written as K into IR. So this is also IR. From the vector diagram. IY, IR, IB. So IY can be written as what here? K square times of IR1. IB can be written as K in time, K times of IR. So if you calculate this, IR plus K cube into IR plus K cube into IR. We know K cube is equal to 1 only. So here, IR1 is equal to IR by 3. IR1 is equal to 3 IR by 3, which is equal to IR. IR1 is equal to IR. So this is the first conclusion. Similarly, let us calculate IR2. Anyway, we know that there is no zero sequence component. It will become zero only. So let us see why it is zero or not. Same way I'm writing here. 1 by 3 IR plus K square into IY. Sorry, IR. Same vector diagram I'm taking. K into IR. So what it will be? 1 by 3 IR plus K square into K square, K to the power of 4, I can write K. K into K, K square times of IR. take IR as common, 1 plus k plus k square, which is equal to 0. So this IR2 is now 0 only. So what is the conclusion here? Fault current IF is equal to IR, which is equal to IR1. What is this IR1? Positive sequence component of the current. Positive sequence component of the current. So this is the only fault to get the positive sequence component, which is equal to zero voltage. Positive sequence component voltage, which is equal to zero. Okay. So this is IR1. So this is important bit for computer examination also. Fault current is equal to IR1. Okay. And we know that VR1 is equal to zero. Therefore, otherwise we'll calculate what is VR1. VR1 is equal to 1 by 3 times of VR plus K into VY plus K square into VB. Okay. We know that VR is equal to VY is equal to VB. So therefore, directly I'm writing 1 by 3 VR 1 plus K square, which is equal to 0. So ultimately it will become 0 only. That's what we have mentioned here. Okay. So when all the three phases are short circuited, the voltages of the three phases are 0 at the fault point. Right. So that the positive sequence network terminal voltage is also 0. Now the final conclusion here, IR1 is equal to, simply it is ER1 by X1 equivalent. So the fault current is what here? The fault current is IR only, which is equal to IR1, which is equal to ER1 by X1 equivalent value. So wherever I'm writing X1, X2, X0, so these are nothing but the equivalent values of that particular network. Okay, so this is regarding triple L fault, and triple LG fault is also having the same way of calculations, So no need to calculate again triple LG fault, because that is also balanced current, balanced fault. So only positive sequence component will be existing. The value will also be same. So no need to calculate again for triple LG fault. Okay, so these are the faults for all the components. So I'll write a glance of all the faults. Okay, so remember here, for LG fault, conclusion, summary of all the fault calculations, the conclusions are VR1 plus VR2 plus VR0 is equal to 0, and IR1 is equal to IR2 is equal to IR0 is equal to IR by 3. That's what we have calculated. And the fault current is IF is equal to IR, which is equal to 3 times of IR1 is equal to 3 times of IR2 is equal to 3 times of IR0. And the fault current can be calculated as 3 into ER1 by X1 equivalent plus X2 equivalent plus X0 equivalent. So this is regarding LG fault calculations. Next, double L fault calculations. Double L fault calculations. In this case, the conclusions made as IR1 is equal to minus of IR2 or IR2 is equal to minus of IR1. These are connected in anti-parallel case. Anti-parallel case, and IR0 is equal to 0 because it is not associated with ground, and VR1 is equal to VR2. Then the fault current IF is equal to IY, which is equal to root 3 times of ER1 by X1 equivalent plus X2 equivalent. These are the calculations made for double L fault. Similarly, double LG fault, in this case IR1 plus IR2 plus IR0 becomes 0, and here VR1 is equal to VR2 is equal to VR0 is equal to VR by 3. So there we got IR1 as ER1 by X1 equivalent plus X2 into X0 by X2 plus X0. Parallel connection of this negative and zero sequence component, and the resultant is connected with the series with the positive sequence component. And the calculation of fault current is 3 times of IR0. And from this IR1, we have to calculate IR0. That is by using current division principle, X2 equivalent divided by X2 plus X0. So this is regarding double LG fault. Now the remaining is triple L fault or balanced fault. I am writing here. Triple L fault. Triple L fault. IF is equal to IR is equal to IR1, which is equal to E by X1 equivalent. Okay. And the only fault which is having the VR1 as 0. So this is also asked in one competitive examination. Okay, so these are the conclusions from all the fault calculations.